Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. couple of hands up.
Our dear God, our Father in heaven, we thank you for the beauty of this Saturday to come here and hear from two brilliant speakers. We ask that we take the lessons here and examine ourselves and see how we can apply it to our lives as we learn more about the book of Jonah. We ask that you go with us throughout this day, keep us safe, forgive us when we fail you, and it's in your name we pray. Amen.
All right, good afternoon. Please grab the Heavenly Library.
down the book of Jonah, and let's go to Jonah chapter 3. I want to read the chapter, and like we did last night, I want you to listen for something. I want you to listen to the heart, all right? You're going to hear words that are certainly going to guide your heart through the reading, but I want you, more importantly, to seek to listen to the hearts of those who are described in this incredible reading. Jonah chapter 3. No worries. All right, Jonah chapter 3. Here we go.
The word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it the message that I tell you." So Jonah arose and he went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, 3 days' journey in breadth. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's journey, and he called out, "Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. Yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They called for a fast. They put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them to the least of them. The word reached the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth and sat in ashes. And he issued a proclamation and published it through Nineveh, "By the decree of the king and his nobles, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth, and let them call out mightily to God. Let everyone turn from his evil way, from the violence that is in his hands. Who knows? God may turn and relent, and turn from his fierce anger, so that we may not perish." When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented of the disaster that he said he would do to them, and he did not do it. Now, is that not an amazing story? It's really one of those stories, it's really hard for us to get into our mind, but the king of Nineveh himself and everybody in the city has now turned to God. Everybody. And not just everybody, but every animal. Now, I got to confess to you, this is the part of the story that I look at and I go, what? Now, hey, we're in Texas, all right? That's what we call thing about Texas. You drive anywhere in Texas and you go a little bit outside the city, you're going to see a cow. You know what I'm saying? You see cows. Cows are everywhere. Those of you that are FFA, you're into livestock, all that. You see cows. You ever seen a cow wearing sackcloth? Just cruising around, minding his own business, you know. You drive along the field, hey, cows. Oh, they got ashes on their head. Yeah, doing good. Can you imagine one of those big livestock shows and here comes a cow walking up? You're going, whoa, what did he do? That cow must be trouble. You know, he's seeking for some forgiveness. Well, buddy, you came to the wrong place if you came to a livestock show, all right? But this was drastic. In fact, did you notice what all the people also did? Or more importantly, didn't do? They didn't eat. No eating. no eating. Now, I'd have had a problem with that. That would have been hard. My wife's got me on a diet right now. We're having a lot of fun with it. It's a Whole30 diet. If you've ever done it, you enjoy beating yourself over the head with a hammer, then you're going to love this kind of a diet. No sugar, no dairy, no bread. You just lick air. Yeah. And drink water. It works. But nobody's eating. In fact, nobody's even drinking water. We're done. We're done. What you find here in the city of Nineveh is a city that is begging, and a city that is implying by their actions, they're in Sheol. They're in Sheol. In other words, we're in a near death or a death-like experience. And we're in Sheol. Hold your place here for just a moment. I want you to go back to chapter 2, and I want you to see this. Nineveh is in a self-imposed Sheol, if you will. When you go back to chapter 2, we go back to Jonah. And Jonah at this time is in the belly of the fish. And what do you do when you're in the belly of a fish? Anybody here ever seen the VeggieTales Jonah movie? Is it just me? Am I showing my age here? Contrary to popular demand, there was no singing in choir going on. If you've seen Pinocchio, you're not lighting a campfire and floating around. No. You're in the belly of a fish. I'm a little claustrophobic by nature. I can't imagine what it's like to be in a fish. So what do? You pray. Listen to his prayer. I called out to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me out of the belly of Sheol. I cried, and you heard my voice. For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the flood surrounded me, and all your waves and your billows passed over me. Then I have said, I have driven away from your sight, that yet I shall again look upon your holy temple. The waters closed in over me to take my life. The deep has surrounded me. Weeds wrapped around my head at the root of the mountains. That's a desperate man. The belly of Sheol. What a great line that is. Sheol, again, the place of the dead. You find it mentioned often in Scripture, especially when you go to the psalmist, and especially the psalmist David talks about being in a death-like experience in Sheol itself, that afterlife, and it's not that pleasant at all. Well, Jonah is in the belly of Sheol, the belly of hell, if you will, and it was true for him. And can you imagine what it was like being in the gut of that fish, the waves billowing over you? Can you imagine what it was like trying to grasp for air every opportunity that maybe presented itself to you? But in the midst of that confined space, in the midst of the belly of that well, in the midst of that darkness, he longs to look to the temple of God, that place of sanctuary, that place of hope. And in the belly of that fish, you find a change. There's something interesting about the belly of a fish. Some of you may be like me. Every now and then you take a few supplements. Fish oil is a popular one now. You want fish oil. Give me a little fish going, help those joints and everything else. You know what's probably the best supplement in the world? And if GNC would sell it, it would be gold. Fish stomach acid. Because it sure worked for Jonah. When you're in the belly of a fish and you're being digested or whatever the Lord had going on in there, it makes you think. It makes you ponder life. But you know what's interesting going back to chapter 4? Nineveh wasn't thrown into a fish. There wasn't some great miracle in which God is going to, well, do in essence what he did to Jonah. He kind of has Jonah with his arm twisted behind his back, doesn't he? Oh, you're going to go to Nineveh. No, I'm not. Oh, yes, you are. I'm not going to go. Yes, you are. I'll throw you in the fish. Let's see how you like it now. Okay, yes, I am. I'm going. But he didn't do that to Nineveh. No, Nineveh just got a sermon. No miracle, just the word of the Lord. And so it brings us to a very interesting and important question. Why'd they repent so easily? Why'd they repent? I mean, just out of curiosity, does anybody here know of somebody who came, quote, to church for the very first time in their life? They've never been, maybe it's some neighbor of yours or friend of yours, some honorary individual, somebody just never been before, and they came in the first time and they heard the preacher preach and they went, oh, yes, here I come. No, it rarely works like that. In fact, that they do come, oh, what they want. Something's going on here. Jonah's sermon really wasn't that great. Jonah, put a little effort into it next time. Yay, 40 days! You're going to be tore up! Oh, man, that's great preaching. Let's respond. It is interesting, isn't it? So why does Nineveh repent so easily? Why did they repent without a miracle? Well, here's what's interesting about Assyria. Assyria, as we studied last night and Justin showed out to us, a very, very wicked nation. History does not sugarcoat it at all. In fact, we have a lot of history on Assyria itself. A lot of their own history has been passed down through archaeological digs and other things. We have found a lot of the antiquities and found a lot of history on Assyria, and truly a very, very, very wicked, evil people. Research tells us also that their empire was expanding and growing, especially in the 9th century BC. Their empire exceeded all the way to Mesopotamia, into the lands over near the Euphrates River, and then all the way back west, right up to the doorstep of Israel itself. But here's what you've got to keep in mind. At this very moment in their history, Assyria is not exactly that superpower. In fact, Assyria as a nation is struggling. There's four very important things that have taken place in Assyria around the time of Jonah. These are those events that aren't necessarily recorded specifically in Scripture, but we find them recorded in secular history, and they're very important for us to see and understand. What I want you to see and understand, first of all, is that there was a solar eclipse about this time. Now, that may not seem like a big deal to us. We have that all the time, maybe mentioned in the news. We'll go out there and maybe try to watch it or catch it. But back in antiquity, a meteorological event like that was a big deal and caused great concern because everybody's wondering, is the God that we serve mad at us? Have we upset some deity? Secondly, Assyria at this time didn't have the strong leadership that they had in times past. In fact, if you were to go and look at a timeline of their leaders, they didn't last very long. They did not have good, strong leadership. In fact, here's what's kind of interesting. We go and we look at this, and it says Jonah went to Nineveh. He didn't say he went to Syria. And Jonah went, and it was the king of Nineveh that repented. It doesn't say the king of Assyria. What it actually can imply is that the nation is a little bit divided, and there are leaders now in certain provinces that are trying to hold things together. Assyria is not what it used to be. And then there's this. This is a big one. This is actually mentioned in Scripture in a couple of places. There was a great earthquake. Secular history records for us an enormous, notable earthquake. Josephus talks about it happening during the reign of Uzziah in the land of Judah, which would have been about this time for Israel, for Jonah. Even Amos mentions it in his text, as well as Zechariah, of a great earthquake. And then in Assyria at this time frame, according to history, there's a famine. widespread hunger. And so in essence, when you kind of look at Assyria, Assyria is ripe for repentance. They're hurting. They're struggling. They're weak. And it's during this point of their existence that God says, I can now get them to listen. Jonah, go preach to them. And so Jonah goes. And they listen. Now, I don't want to make this sound like their repentance was simply due to physical prosperity or physical hope, but the suffering certainly got their attention. And so now when a prophet who has been spit out by a great fish comes walking into the city, maybe we ought to listen to him. A prophet that has come from Israel, where we talked about last night, of a nation that is growing and expanding, maybe we better listen to him. A prophet who, because of his actions, a tempestuous sea was sent to get his attention. Maybe we better listen to him. But here's where the story really gets amazing. It's not just that they listen, but their repentance. Well, their repentance to a large degree is over the top. I want you to notice three things here because this is so very important. And they come from the king himself. They come from the king of Nineveh. Go back to verse six. And if there's ever a passage in the story of Jonah that you need to take note, if you're a person who likes to underline in your Bible or make a notation, verse six is your verse. Verse six is the story of Jonah. Because what you find in verse 6 is you find the attitude of somebody who is truly bearing fruits worthy of repentance. The first thing you notice about this king is the king lays aside his robe. I want you to get this visual picture in your mind, all right? This is the king of the land, all right? This is the guy in charge of everything. This is the guy who makes all the decrees. This is the guy with all the power. And when the word comes to him that they're going to be destroyed by Jehovah God, when the word comes to him that you think an earthquake and a famine and all sorts of bad, when the word comes to him that they are wicked and they know it and they better change, he gets up from his throne and he takes off his robe. What's the significance? Well, the robe is the symbol of his power, his royalty. He sits upon a luxurious seat. He carries with him the adornment of majesty and glory. And he says, I'm giving this up. And not only does he give it up and humble himself before the Lord, he lays it aside. We actually sing a song. Sometimes y'all ever sung the invitation song, I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb? You ever sung that one? No, I'm not going to sing it to you. I won't put you through that. All right. My sister knows my singing. She doesn't want to hear it. But there is a line in that popular song, lay aside the garments that are stained with sin. I'll be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Taking off the robe was a symbol of I'm taking off my old self. I'm taking off all my prominence. I'm taking off all my dignity. I'm taking off the man that I used to be. And I'm laying it aside. I'm giving up my place, my authority. And he doesn't just take it off. He puts something else on. Sackcloth. All right. What is sackcloth? Just out of curiosity, anybody here ever worn sackcloth? Anybody just put it on and just felt like, no, I'm in a sackcloth mood? No? There. Most of you probably don't even know what sackcloth is. Anybody here ever been in a three-legged race where you've had the little burlap sack bags You know, those really nice, fun, comfortable burlap sack bags that you're thinking the whole time it's scratching up and down your legs through your blue jeans. Ooh, I could go for some of this. This would be nice. You know, why don't they make underwear out of this? That'd be great. Well, that was the point. Sackcloth was intended to be uncomfortable. It was intended to rub. It was intended to chafe. It was intended to irritate. And so the king not only takes off his robe, he puts on sackcloth. And you'll notice all the people do it as well. It's the clothing of mourners. It's the clothing of those who are hurting. One commentator, Albert Barnes, said it like this, speaking of this passage. The king had conquered enemies by valor, but yet he conquered God by humility. The wise king who, for the saving of his people, owns up himself as a sinner now rather than a king. And he forgets that he is a king at all, fearing God, the king of all. And not only does he put on sackcloth, he covers himself with ashes. What's the whole point? You ever wonder why somebody did that in scripture? You actually find that recorded a lot. Job will say, I covered myself in ashes. You find David mentioning in Psalms chapter 30, I've been covered with sackcloth. Well, what was the whole point of the sackcloth and ashes? Why would somebody do that? What was the point really of the ashes? Well, the ashes was simply a reference to the dirt. It was a reference to the ground. It was a reference to what is earthly and has no value. It was to cover yourself in what is to be seen as dirty or filthy. In other words, it is to signify that I am mourning and hurting. And nobody in their right mind when they gets up in the morning goes, you're not going to put on some dirt today as I go out. That's good. Man, I need a little more dirt. In fact, generally we're trying to wash dirt off. But the mourner is showing their filth. They're showing their stain. They're showing their sin. And it's not enough just to cover the king or cover the people. They cover the animals. Now, what is the point of that? Well, you probably have seen it sometimes in funerals, especially the funerals of dignitaries, the animals that may be out there part of the processional. And what do they cover them in? They cover them in something black. That's our custom today. You wear black. In antiquity, it was to cover in ashes, to be mourning. And why are they doing all this? The whole city is doing this. Why? Go to verse 9. For who knows? God may turn and relent and turn from his fierce anger. You know what I find even more amazing when you really consider the story? Is that they did all this hoping for mercy. Not expecting mercy, not demanding mercy, certainly not earning mercy. But they did it hoping for a gift that they didn't deserve. Now, what's going on back in Israel? Anybody know? Anybody remember last time? What's going on back in Israel? Wickedness. What's their king doing? Oh man, he's starting his own cult. But in Nineveh, they're crying out to Jehovah. Kind of reminds us of the word of Jesus when he ran into a Gentile once who showed great faith. I have not seen this great faith in all of Israel. but I have seen it in Nineveh. Go to chapter 4 real quick. You would expect Jonah to be excited. Everybody listened to his sermon. How cool is that? Somebody actually listened. They stayed awake during my sermon. They responded. What does Jonah do? It displeased Jonah exceedingly. You mean the whole city came forward? Yes. And he turns his anger on God. And he prayed to the Lord and he said, "Oh Lord, oh Jehovah, is this not what I said when I was yet in my country? Is this not why I made haste to flee to Tarshish? For I knew you were a gracious God and that you were merciful, that you were slow to anger, that you were abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. Therefore now, oh Lord, please take my life from me. For it is better for me to die than to live." And the Lord said to Jonah, "Do you do well to be angry?" Well, Jonah reveals why he left in the first place, doesn't he? God is merciful. God is forgiving. God will bless even the enemy. And what's his reaction? Kill me. Kill me. Who says that to God? Jonah does. I don't want to jump into Justin's territory, but I do want to just give you my little opinion on the next part. Why did he hang around, you know? So why does Jonah hang around after everybody's come forward, after everybody's repented and God? Why does he hang around? I think he's just hoping God's going to change his mind and he wants to be there for the apocalypse, you know? When it rains down fire like on Sodom and Gomorrah, and he wants to go home and tell everybody, "Woo, I saw Nineveh get wiped out. Woo, it was great. You should have seen it." That's why I think he was waiting. But what you see is, it's actually God who's waiting. And he's not waiting for the pagan. He's not waiting for the Assyrians. He's not waiting for Nineveh. He's not waiting for Nineveh's king. He's waiting for Jonah. He's waiting for Jonah. What's interesting when you look at the whole story is actually a parallel. And what it actually shows us is two hearts. And so what you see are two hearts and how they respond to God. You see, first of all, there's Jonah. Jonah is given miracles. Jonah is given signs. Jonah is given supernatural experiences to help him turn back to God. Nineveh, they just get preaching. That's all they get is preaching. Jonah, when God comes to him, he takes off running. He goes in the opposite direction. Nineveh falls on their knees. They don't run at all. They just immediately fall and say, "Please don't take us out. Please be merciful to us." They repent. Jonah despises God. "Oh, you're so merciful and nice. Oh, I can't believe you do." Just out of curiosity, and I bet some of you can raise your hand. I probably shouldn't say this, but my younger sister here. Anybody here the oldest in your family? Anybody the oldest? Yeah. Anybody here dealing with the plight of life that your parents are harder on you than all your younger siblings? And they get away with, raise your hand if your little brother and your little sister get away with murder. Raise your hand. Come on, right now. Yeah. Yes, they do. The attitude of Jonah. Give it to them. Spank them. Don't give them mercy. I want to hear them cry. And Jonah despises God for being a forgiving God. While Nineveh is not just accepting of God's mercy. Notice Nineveh was accepting of Jonah. They let him come into the city and preach for 3 days. How does an Israelite get in the city and preach for 3 days and nobody confronts him? Now, granted, I'm sure the fish story got out. That probably carried a little weight. Jonah hates God. Nineveh sought God. Jonah rejects God's mercy. Just kill me. While Nineveh welcomes mercy for all. Another theological point here for you to consider, folks, is this. If you've ever wondered in the Old Testament, well, what about people outside of Israel? Well, how did God deal with them? Here you go. Here you go. What, did they have to go back and keep all that old law stuff? Here you go. And what you see is God seeks to save all men. And remember Jonah's sermons in Israel? We're going to win. We're going to win. All we do is win. It reminds me of a line from C.S. Lewis in the Screwtape Letters. If you've ever had the opportunity to read that wonderful book, then you understand maybe a little bit more in a very dynamic way and maybe how Satan works in our lives and tempts us. But C.S. Lewis said this, "Prosperity knits a man to the world. He feels that he is finding his place in it, while really it's the world that's finding a place in him." Prosperity was not a friend to Israel. While suffering, to a large degree, was a friend to Nineveh. So why doesn't Jonah repent? You go back and you look at chapter 2 and you listen to his prayer, and I think you could say, well, he's definitely got a changed heart. But does he ever put on sackcloth? Does he ever cover himself with ashes? Does he ever plead with God and say, God, forgive me. Oh, I was so wrong. I tell you what, it's a little bit debatable. He knows he's in a tight place, pardon the pun, but the fact of the matter is he's there. And it's only when he's there that he seeks God. When he gets out of there, he's not really seeking God anymore. So did he really repent? I think it'd be safe to say Jonah, before the fish and even after the fish, suffers from a lot of pride. What scripture tell us about pride? Proverbs 16:18, pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Proverbs 6, verse 17, what's one of the many things that the Lord hates? Haughty eyes. Your parents ever done that to you? Don't you look at me like that? You give me that look, I'll slap that right off of you. God hates it because it's a rebellious look. The eyes are insight into the heart. Romans 12, verse 3, do not think more highly of yourself than you ought to think. It's interesting how that sneaks into our lives. If I share a story with you, will you promise not to think less of me? Promise? This is church, please. When I was in high school, I know you may find this hard to believe, I went to a very, very large high school. It was a 5A school, Lubbock, Monterey. Big school. Big kids in our big school. And I know you'll find this hard to believe, I didn't make the football team. Or the basketball team. I made the wrestling team. It was great. In fact, the wrestling coach sought me out. In my very first year of wrestling in high school, I went undefeated. Undefeated. There was nobody in the entire county in my weight class. Coach, you got anybody under a 90? They throw me out the middle of the mat and they say, anybody else under 90? Raise his hand, winner! Oh, you never felt like a winner when you win that way, yeah. And then the coach would say, all right, you got anybody else? Yeah, I got a kid 130. He's not wrestling. Put him out here. This little guy needs some mat time. And I'd spend 9 minutes on my back. I never got pinned, but I did lose 12 to nothing once. But officially, undefeated. So I got on the golf team. Golf team, pretty cool. Got to travel a lot. And I practiced hard. Had to work at my dad's store while we were practicing and doing that part of growing up. And so maybe didn't get to practice as much as I wanted. That was part of life. But my parents were phenomenal. They gave us a lot of opportunities. And I was playing golf. And I never could win. I would practice so hard, I never could win. And I'll never forget, we'd be in district tournaments and we'd be playing against some of these other guys. And there was this one guy in particular. He was from one of the other schools in the district. And he was the most foul-mouthed, sorriest individual in the world. But his dad was a golf pro and he had the most beautiful swing and he always won. And I can remember talking to God, why in the world are you letting that filthy guy win? And I'm going to church every Sunday. I'm doing everything I can. Why can't I? And I remember I actually had that prayer and I had that frustration. Why isn't God letting me? If I was to win, I would be this great ambassador for goodness and righteousness. And I would be the guy standing up on the podium praising God and giving him all the glory. Why don't I get to win? It wasn't until a few years later when I matured that did I deserve to win more than that guy? Really? Who do I think I am, that I'm God's gift to the world? That just because I go to church, just because I may do some things that are spiritual, that I'm better than everybody else and I deserve more? See what happens to us? You see what pride can do to us? I tell you, I think it's very important for all of us to see that when you look at Nineveh, don't see Nineveh. Lord willing, you see yourself. You see yourself. And if there's anything that the Lord is trying to teach Jonah, is Jonah, look at them. Don't look above them. Don't look over them, but see what you need to see. And here's what I want to leave you with is your take home. Repentance. Why is it so hard for us to repent? Why is it so hard for us to say, I'm sorry? Why is it so hard for us to admit I was wrong? Why is it so hard? Why couldn't Jonah see it? I want to suggest to you three things real quick. Number one, why do we not repent? Because we fail to see ourselves clearly. Yes, we may say in a very gratuitous way, I'm a sinner, we're all sinners. But deep down in our hearts, we're saying, but yet I'm better than that guy. I'm better than her. Did you see what they said? The humanity. And we can't see ourselves. You ever caught thinking your church is better than all the other churches? Well, of course it is. We do everything right. Or my school, my education is better. I mean, let's just be honest. Homeschooling is much better than public schooling, right? All public school kids are going to hell. I just, it's in the scripture. No. But some people act like that, don't they? And some people are invert it. And then all of a sudden you got a battle. No, my way's better. My way's better. My way's better. And we get ourselves in positions of setting ourselves up thinking that I'm better because of what I do. And we fall into the trap of Jonah. And we got to be very careful. Very careful. Just because you're making choices that are good for you, God bless you. But if God gives us the opportunity and the freedom to make another choice, applaud those who make it. And see yourself clearly. I share to you the homeschool thing because we homeschooled our kids. And I'm proud to say they're not the dorks. At least I don't think they are. They could be. I mean, I'd see them clearly. Sometimes, folks, we got to be careful of what we make a battle. And we need to be very careful of what we make battles sometimes scripturally in our eyes as well. We need to respect the freedom that God gives us in His Word. What God wants us to do is to see ourselves not through our own eyes, but look to see ourselves through His eyes. He wants to mold us after His will. In Ephesians 2 and in verse 10, when you talk about grace being given to all men, He says, why? Because we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. Philippians 2 verse 13, while you work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, why? For it's God who will and works in you, but for His good pleasure. He wants to mold you, and He's only going to be able to mold you when you decide to look at yourself through His eyes, not your own. Secondly, why do we not repent like we should at times? Because we fail to see our own need for guidance, our own need for correction, and our own need for wisdom. Just out of curiosity, anybody here get a spanking as a kid? Now, whoa, before you raise your hands, let me qualify spanking. Not the spanking you get from your grandparents, all right? They spank you with a little Snickers bar and then give you two more on your way out the door. That's not a spanking. I'm talking about something that was a near-death experience, all right? That's a spanking. Anybody get one of those? Yeah, all right. Did anybody go back and say thank you? You go, oh, Mom, Dad, I just want you to know, I really appreciate the guidance and correction you just gave me. Because I really needed it. In fact, I'm probably going to need one tomorrow. So if we'll just meet the same time tomorrow. No. But there's a lot of us when we got a lot older had the faith to say that to our parents, didn't we? I've been doing something way out of my comfort zone this summer. I've been writing a manuscript that's going to be published. Why did I ever agree to this? I'm not a good writer, and so I sought out a lady at our church who is an incredible writer, English person, this, that, and the other. And I mean, all I see is red here. Did I write anything? We are now through our 10th version of it. And she sent me this note this last time. She goes, I wish I had a picture of your first one and your last one. I said, I don't want to see that first one. She goes, because the difference between your first one and your last one is like one of those big weight loss pictures of somebody who lost it. Thank you. Yes. So now I'm a Jenny Craig, you know, mama. But she's made me a better writer. In 1 Peter chapter 3, you have something very important written to all of us about how you react and respond, especially to your brethren. Those of you who are older, teach the younger. Those of you who are younger, listen to the older. If there's any advice I would love to give all of our teams, is surround yourself with mentors who will guide you, discipline you, correct you, and share with you wisdom. Because that audacious moment in your life where you think you're above it, you are headed for a disaster. I.e. Jonah. And then thirdly, Why do we not repent like we should? Because we sometimes really fail to see the need for mercy in our life. I need mercy. I need God to relent to me, to forgive me, to love me. And what God is trying to say through this whole story to Jonah is, I do love you more than you could ever imagine. I do seek to be merciful more than you could ever imagine. But I can't give it to you unless you seek it. Nineveh sought the mercy of God. And God forgave the whole city. The whole city was forgiven by God. Thank you so much for your kind attention. We're going to continue this story with Justin's lesson here in just a moment. But if you allow me, I want to just close with a prayer real quick, and then we'll turn it over to Justin. Will you bow with me, please? Our Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for your love. And even, dear Lord, at this very moment, as we're surrounded by this weather and these storms, we can feel your presence and know that it's simply by the touch of your finger that you move the climate and the weather around us. But dear Lord, you moved your hands to